Hello. Hello, everybody. Good evening to everybody. My name is Nehru Cherukupalli, and I'm the interim executive director of the Asian American Asian Research Institute. And we normally have the Friday evening talks, which are quite interesting. And the number of audience that we get varies from time to time and depends upon the particular topic. And from the audience that are gathered this evening, I believe that this talk should be really interesting. And I'm looking at a book that our speaker wrote. This is what it looks like. And I was just chatting with him, and I said, I want to find out how to climb to the top. And he said, yeah, you can do it. And I believe him. Let me formally introduce Professor Cameron here. Randolph W. Cameron is a professor at the Medgar Evers College School of Business, and he is the founder and president of Cameron Enterprises, a New York-based management consulting firm with client experience that includes Avon products. Some of you should know them. Gray Advertising, I don't know who they are. Public-private ventures, yes, I know a lot of them. The Ford Foundation, oh yes, I love to get their money. Walsh Construction, yeah, that too. Yale University, the Children's Aid Society, United Way of New York City, and New York State Division of Youth. And I have the distinct pleasure of introducing and inviting Dr. Cameron to give us his talk and tell us how we can climb to the top. Dr. Cameron.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. Good evening. Can you all hear me? All right. I have a pretty loud voice, and I will try to project so that it will give me an opportunity to move around a little bit. But it is important that we have an opportunity to dialogue together. So I want to preface my remarks by saying to you, we need to interact, you and I, okay? That's very important. I do not have a desire to stand here all evening and just lecture to you without having an exchange. So I encourage you to think about questions that you would like to ask me, because perhaps the question that you ask might be the most helpful to you if I respond to it appropriately. So do not hesitate to think about the questions that you would like to ask. I have some prepared text, and I will talk from that text. But I think the most important part of this exchange will be questions and answers. But we will continue. I want to first thank the Asian American Asian Research Institute, AARI, at the City University of New York for inviting me to come and talk with you tonight. I stand here before you in great humility. You are a very important group. In fact, the members of this organization represent some of the best in this country. In fact, you are, in my opinion, the future of this country. I don't know how many of you are actual members and how many are guests. Can I see, just by a show of hands, how many are members of AAIRI and how many are guests? Oh, okay. All right, good. That's good. But the reason that I've made this statement is because I believe all of you present are not just content to settle for things as they are, but as they can be, with the right vision, determination, and effort. And it does take vision, determination, and effort to to climb that mountain. However, I think that most of you know that the climb will not be easy. The climb to the summit of this mountain called success will not be easy. Now, I have an exercise that I would like for you to participate in with me, okay? I invite you to join me in a perception exercise. And I'm going to flash a few pictures on the screen, and I would like to get your perception of these pictures. I'll remove this because I think I will be able to travel around a little bit more. So please tell me what you see in the first picture. Raise your hand and I will acknowledge. This is picture one. Number one, take a look at it and tell me what you see. Raise your hand. Yes. An urn and two silhouettes. All right. Who else would care to comment? Yes.
Two faces.
Two faces. Wow. Okay. Anyone else would comment? Please don't hesitate. Don't be afraid. There are no wrong answers. No wrong answers. No one else? Okay. So we have an urn and some silhouettes and faces. Okay. Let's go to number two. Please, comment. What do you see? Am I in your way?
Face, two posing face to face.
Two faces,
yeah.
Posing face to face.
Yeah.
All right. Anyone else? Yes.
I see the same but opposite colors.
You see the same as what? As number one?
Number one, they have the faces, but it's in white.
Yes.
And on the other side, it's in black.
Right.
And the urn is black, and that one is white.
All right. Wonderful. Anyone else? I sense that there's some folks that are bashful here, and they think that maybe they're going to get it wrong. There are no right and wrong answers. Right? No right and wrong answers. Okay. I want to share with you that what you have identified is correct. Those images are there, no question about it. Now, I thought that was pretty easy, so I'd like to flash another image and see if I can't get you to respond to that, see if it isn't more challenging. And you're smiling, so you've probably seen it before. Let's look at this image and tell me what you see. It's number three. Look real hard. Yes?
So I see an old lady with a hat and a feather, and then I also see a young lady with a looking behind her or to the side, so it's kind of a silhouette.
Oh my, you see a lot. An old lady and a young lady in the same picture? Oh, I'm impressed. And then a hat with a feather? Oh, all right. Anyone else?
Please.
I saw a young lady with black hair with a feather on top and then a hat on her head.
Young lady. Do you see the old lady that she spoke about?
I didn't see the old lady.
Don't see it. Okay. All right. Anyone else? No one? So the rest of you don't see anything, is that correct? No picture at all, huh? Nothing, absolutely nothing. Oh, that's disturbing. That's disturbing. Or perhaps we're just a little, yes?
Well, the lady's looking.
Profile?
Back, yeah.
Or
we can only see the ear.
I see. Only see the ear. Okay. All right. I won't challenge you too much because I sense that you haven't warmed up yet, but it's okay.
In the first picture, there is the opportunity to see an image that resembles a goblet, no question about it. I've heard people say a wine glass or a vase, you know. There is the opportunity to see images of profiles of faces. Yes, that's a possibility. And other possibilities, which I will not identify. And then picture two, a similar, similar images exist, but in different shades of color. All right. And here, in three, who was the person that said they saw two faces? Yes. There is the possibility that two images coexist in this picture, all right? And I will try to describe them to you. First, the young lady, which you said was an image of a young woman, an image of a young woman, which actually is a profile, okay? And let me try to outline that for you. If you can imagine this as a feather, all right? And this as the hair of a female, and this as her eye, okay? And then her her face on chin line, all right? And it comes around like that, and this is her ear. She's looking in this direction. This is a hat. Do you see that?
Yeah.
You all see it? No? Yes?
Yes.
Oh, okay, all right. I thought I was the only one going crazy here. All right, let me show you another image that coexists with this profile. And you described it as an old lady. Okay, we'll go along with that. All right, here's the old lady. This is like a kerchief, if you will. The old lady's hair in black. This is an eye. This is another eye. This is her nose. Underneath her nose is the top lip, okay? And here's her mouth. And underneath that is her chin. And then she has a shawl around her neck. They go, oh, I see it. Do you all see it? Or you don't see it?
I don't see it.
I still don't see it. But it's okay. It's okay that you don't see it. It's okay that you don't see it. All right, don't be disturbed, all right? That's my point. Maybe we can turn the lights on. This is really a perception exercise. I wish to make a point. And the point is this. The truth is, we all have our own special perceptions based largely on our personalities and our experiences. And if you don't remember anything else that I've said tonight, remember this. We see things not as they are, we see things as we are, from our own point of view. And that is why it's possible for two people to go to a movie theater, both of them witness this movie, and yet they see different things at the theater. Interesting, isn't it? And another point that I'm trying to make here, I'd like to make, is that sight may not always be accurate in our experiences. So there are times when we're traveling on our journey that we may have the need to use another form of sight other than the sight of our two eyes. And I identify this sight as the sight of the third eye. Where is the third eye? Yes?
The brain.
Are we aware that there is another eye? I call it the eye of what? Intuition. Intuition. And this eye can give us a better view of our pathway
to success. I invite you to consider how you would want to use this third eye, because it can give you a much better vision of really what the landscape is all about. As we've noticed, people see things differently, looking at the same picture. Okay? And that's not a bad thing. It's because, as I said, we see things not as they are, but as we are, from where we're coming from. I wrote a book entitled Finding Your Way to the Top. It is full of signposts and symbols of those who, for those who have a need to find their way to the top of the mountain that's called success. It's really a how-to book. And essentially, this book says, go this way, not that way. For many years, I refused to even consider writing a book. And the reason that I wouldn't consider it is because I've always believed that one should not write a book unless one has something to say. And it occurred to me that I may not have anything to say that was worth publishing. But a very dear friend of mine who worked with me at the Avon Corporation convinced me that I did have something to say. And that person worked with me for 10 years at the Avon Corporation. And they said to me that they believed that I had some insight into what we call organizational America, or corporate America, if you will. And that that information should be shared with others. What I discovered in my climb to the top of the mountain is that the path is not clearly marked all along the way. And while the world is full of signs and symbols, for mankind, we require meaning and understanding. Now, many of you are involved in research, or have been involved in research, and so you know that meaning and understanding is important. It's not enough to gather information, you know, and collect it. You need to apply some meaning to it. And so we go through a process of analyzing and evaluating so that you can apply some meaning. That's an important consideration. And that's why I suggest to you that we utilize this third eye, this eye of intuition, to help us with our sight so that we can see things right. If we see things right, we will be able to set them right. Also, when using the eye of intuition, it allows us to get to a high place. Now, I'm not talking about a physical high place. I'm talking about a high place in consciousness. You need to be conscious about the ability to come up higher than you have been functioning before, to see things much greater. And that is possible by going to a high place. It enables you to see the signs and the symbols much more clearly. Now, let me ask this question. How many of you would like to improve their opportunity to climb to the top of this mountain called success? Raise your hand if you have a desire to do that. Wonderful. Everybody wants to climb to the top. I understand. Well, as I indicated to you earlier, this co-worker of mine encouraged me to put some words to print because she believed that I had some insight. In fact, she so much believed that I had some insight, she made a proposal to me. She said, Mr. Cameron, if you will write a manuscript, I will type that manuscript on my IBM Selectric typewriter. And in those days, we didn't have desktop computers. So you know how long ago this is. But in fact, she did exactly that. I wrote the manuscript for not this book, but a previous book, longhand. And because she supported this idea, she was willing to invest her personal time, and she typed it at home on an IBM Selectric typewriter. Now, frankly, I cannot tell you how important that proposal was for me, but it was one that I could not resist. If someone is willing to invest so much time and energy, how could you resist? What she said to me is that this pathway to the top is often not marked, certainly not clearly marked. And people often do not take the time, those who have climbed the mountain do not take the time to mark it, the path for others coming behind. And she said, my condition for typing this manuscript is that you identify these signs and symbols so people climbing behind you will be able to access the summit. And that is what I essentially have attempted to do. I cannot identify all of the many pathways to the top of the mountain for you. I cannot do that. But you can identify those pathways. Okay. It is important that you understand that the vision that you require exists in you. It's already there. It's already there. A person told me a little story about a gardener who was attempting to water his garden. And he discovered that there was no water coming out of the hose, you know, to put on the flowers. And he couldn't figure it out. He was very confused. But then he looked down and he discovered that he was standing on the water hose. And of course, if you are standing on the water hose, no water will come out. So it's important for you to make sure that you are seeing it right, that you're not part of the problem in terms of your vision. Okay? That is an important ingredient. I want to share with you the words of a man that I believe understood the importance of climbing this mountain. And I quote, I have learned that success is not to be measured, not so much by the position that one reaches in life, as by the obstacles which he has to overcome while trying to succeed. And this particular person was Booker T. Washington. He was an educator and a leader of people. And I repeat, I have learned that success is to be measured not so much by the position that one has reached in life, but by the obstacles in which he has to overcome. Now, how many of you feel satisfied with the career path that you are on? Anyone? Yes. You feel satisfied with it? You want to share with us what path that is?
Well,
where are you going?
Well, I just started working at Girl Scouts, so it's been a really exciting position for me. It's program manager, team leadership opportunities. So it's nice because it's kind of combining my love of empowering girls with, you know, actually engaging them with opportunities to, you know, expand their cultural awareness. So, you know, before in corporate America, a lot of my work was really just driven towards the bottom line. And so now it's into incorporating and helping girls to become leaders. So it's a nice story.
Wonderful. So So now you're in on the nonprofit side.
Mm-hmm.
Good, good. Anyone else want to share with us? No? All right. So you think, for the most part, that you are traveling on the right road, the right path? Okay. How many of you feel that you need to change the direction that you're going in? Why?
I feel like I've reached the top of the path that I've been on, and I need to change the direction.
Okay. Can you share with us what path you've been on?
I'm a professor,
mm-hmm.
and I've been teaching for 25 years.
Okay.
And I feel like I'm of the old school, and there's a new school of professors coming in. I don't identify with them, and I don't feel like the administration is looking at the old school anymore, and we've become a number.
Okay.
And I don't feel like I'm in a place where I'm appreciated, and it's making me sad. And I used to be very excited about academia, very excited about work, and I felt I was in the right place. Those feelings are faded.
Good. Thank you for sharing with us. How many of you are not sure which way you're going, which way to go? A little confused? Okay.
Would you share?
Pardon me?
Sorry, go ahead.
No, please. You want to share?
No. So I'm a year out of college, mm-hmm. and I'm working at a nonprofit right now. It's a good organization, and I generally like my job. But we'll see where I end up in a few years. I'm looking at, you know, doing some other things after I get out of this job in a year. I'm applying for fellowships and things like that right now. We'll see where that takes me.
Good. Well, yes.
Yeah, I want to share my directional kind of intuition. My feeling is that this country is falling down in a lot of aspects. And, you know, if you take a look around the things happening, you would be really, really disappointed. And I myself kind of like have become this Russian, you know, about what's happening in this country. Like if you're reading the papers every day, and the people high up, very high up a position, they're corrupt. And the organizational, you know, big corporations, which are working, corruption everywhere.
Yes.
So this is to make me, you know, feel very kind of disappointed, and also disillusioned.
Right.
And then I feel that you know, somewhere, actually someplace else in the world, I think it's doing better despite their problems, issues. But, you know, people are more kind of like energized and in a much stronger drive than people here. We lost a lot of entrepreneurship spirit, and people tend to, you know, talk about more about, like you said, climbing the corporate ladder rather than do start the hardest things, you know, do a lot of, you know, startups themselves. I think that we're losing a lot of that kind of like originality and the initiatives. So I think I'm like right now I feel I need to redirect myself.
Fair enough. Yes, you have a comment?
Yeah, I just want to follow up with what this gentleman just said. I think corruption, I'm not saying anything for the United States because I'm coming from China, where the corruption is prevailing everywhere. But I don't think corruption should be the thing that disappoints you the most and stop you going on and growing up. So I think right now, I got out of school right now for 2 years already, and I think throughout the path, I walked I walked through, I realized one thing. I realized is really to protect the things that you value most in your heart, and don't be too influenced to impact by the world, and hold your hope high. And really, this is the third eye I have. So I'm really pursuing my own path right now. I don't know what the future is going to be, but I have my hope in my heart. And my career, my venture, my enterprise, I'm going to strive for in the future is to really impact the people around me, to have them also to protect their values and the really precious thing in their hearts, and to really grow up like that, not to affected by the corruption, by the other things, get disappointed and going all the way down. So this is just my take, and I really want to know, I want to know if I'm taking the right path by really proving by myself if I'm doing this all right.
Well, thank you for sharing with me. I think it is important that we stay focused, reason being that there are many things that will go on around us in the world, okay, that we have no control over. Yes, it's true that you read things in the papers like Enron and how, you know, corruption has occurred.
And AIM is another example.
Exactly.
And, you know, people like, you know, politicians.
Yes,
in
politicians,
Jersey,
yes.
Actually,
all of them.
You know,
oh, that's so true, that's true. But what is really important is not so much about what is going on around us as much it is what's going on inside of us. And our determination to stay focused. Now let me give you some suggestions on changing direction. You need to change direction when your career path no longer feels that you are going in the right direction. Simplistic, but yes. If you no longer feel you're going in the right direction, that is an indication of need to change. When your existing travel is not getting you closer to your intended goal or your destination. When you discover that you are not growing mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. When you, and I'm now speaking a little bit to the lady on my right, when you do not feel or no longer feel passionate about the work that you are performing. And I would just like to take a little aside here. A gentleman who was a mentor of mine, and I will tell you a little bit about him. When I first got started, he managed a company. It was a consulting firm, and I was working there as an intern. I observed him and his enthusiasm and his commitment to his work. And I said to him, Mr. Gibson, how is it that you are so in love with this work? You seem to be so energized and constantly working. He said, yes, it is true. I do love my work. He said, I love it so much that even if I didn't get paid for it, I would still perform it. And that is the kind of passion that we need to have for our work. Now, as it turned out, he did get compensated for his work, but he was willing to admit that even if he didn't get compensated, and you stop and think about some of the athletes, you know, basketball players, baseball players, soccer players, these individuals are fortunate enough to be participating in an activity that they would do for nothing. They love the sport, but they also happen to get compensated for it. And so there is a challenge for us in climbing this mountain called success, to find that balance of passion for our work. Okay. Now, the experience of needing to change careers first happened to me many years ago. I found myself working for a social agency. It was called the Youth House for Boys. And I was a group worker. Essentially, I was helping young people who got in trouble with the law. And it was a nice agency and a good job, but it was not for me. and I recognized it after 3 years of working in group work, that this was not the place for me. And I would have to find a way to bring about change, a new job, a new career, something that was suitable and that I could feel passionate about. And I say to you, all of you, that you really don't want to just work to live and live to work. You don't want to do that. You need to feel good about yourself and passionate about your work. Now, I had a degree in business administration at the time that I was in social work, and I realized that, you know, while I had been trained as a business person, I was not working in that area. And I found that one morning, when I awakened, a conversation was going on inside of my head. And this conversation sounded something like this: Randolph Cameron, you are going in the wrong direction. This is not the career that you need to be working in. You have trained and studied as a business person. You need to practice business. Now, I know some of you might think that that's amusing, but that was a very profound conversation. And we have conversations with ourselves all the time. And let me ask you, how many of you have a dialogue with yourself? They call it self-talk. Don't be embarrassed. Come on. Yes, we do. We know we have self-talk all the time. All right? We engage in self-talk, and that's an important conversation. It is a conversation that stems and is driven and motivated from that third eye. It's the eye of intuition. And so I had that profound conversation with myself, so much so that I found myself doing something that many of us do, and I encourage you to try not to do it. I sent my body to work, but I left my mind and my spirit at home. Anyone here doing that now? They send a physical presence to work, but the mental and spiritual presence is left at home. Oh, you see it occurring on the job all the time, don't you? Huh? You see people walking around, you say, oh my gosh, where's that person's mind? Or that person has no spirit, or somebody has to do their job because they don't have any spirit in it. It is possible for us to do that. It happens in the workplace all the time. Some people get fired because they continue to not bring the mind and the spirit with the body to the job. Now, I had another experience that occurred the very next day, that I sent this physical presence, but not my mind or my body. And some of the people that was working with me could see that my mental presence was not there. I was somewhere else. But the other experience I had was that I began immediately to create a career plan, one that would change my life. And I'll tell you what I did. I called someone who was kind enough to tell me about a job opportunity as a salesperson. Now, I'm a social worker at this point. Right? And they said, they're interviewing. You call up and go over there. Interview. I said, sure, why not? And I did. Unfortunately or fortunately, depending upon which way you want to look at it, the gentleman who was interviewing for these two sales positions had already hired people for the job. This gentleman ran a management consulting firm, and he had an assignment, and the assignment was to find two salespeople, and he'd already done that by the time I got there. And so I said to him, well, you know, I don't know anything about business, although I've studied business, but I've never had any practical hands-on experience. What is a management consulting firm? How does it work? What does it do? How do you get compensated? And he was kind enough to share that with me. I thanked him, and I went home. That happened on a Friday. On Monday morning, my third eye of intuition came up with a plan. Said, call that man back and ask for an interview again. And when you go back, I want you to go with a proposal. And so I did. And fortunately, this gentleman who was head of this consulting firm consented to see me. And I said to him, Mr. Gibson, I know that you need an experienced person to do the work that you do here as a consultant, and I have no experience, I admit that. I said, but if you will accept me as an intern, I will come to your office every day, 5 days a week, from 8 in the morning until 2 in the afternoon, because I do have a paying job to pay my rent as a social worker. But I will come here 5 days a week as an intern to learn what it takes to be a management consultant. And you won't have to pay me. I won't accept one dime. And he was so taken by my offer, he said to me, well, Mr. Cameron, if you're willing to do that, I will do something for you. I will teach you everything I know. And the truth of the matter was, the man was brilliant. He was brilliant. I'll tell you how long ago this was. He typed on an IBM Selectric typewriter, but he could type 85 words a minute without making an error. He could write, and he wrote published three books. He had the mental capacity, the memory, to be able to take each person in this room's first and last name as you entered the room, and then when you left after the meeting, he could give you back the first and last name. He had that kind of memory. And so, for 1 year, I was an intern. Didn't get paid, but I learned an awful lot about that business. So much so that at the end of the year, he did in fact hire me. I was hired as an entry-level management consultant. Now, what is an entry-level management consultant? It's a person who doesn't have a lot of skill, but is still willing to learn. And here's what he did. He gave me a stack of letters. He says, Mr. Cameron, I'm going to make you a new business development person for this management consulting firm. He says, so that will be your first challenge. Oh, yes, later on you will learn to advise people, but you have to know something in order to advise people. People will not pay you unless you have information that they view to be of value. He said, but right now I want you to be a new business development person, and I'm going to train you to do that. Here are a stack of letters. Go through all of these letters. And I did. These letters were alphabetized. And the first letter that he received, the firm received, was from Avon. I read the letter, and it said, thank you very much, Mr. Gibson, for writing us, but we don't need your services. And what all of these letters had in common is that they were all turned down letters. And so I said to Mr. Gibson, you are asking me to do something, but there doesn't appear to be an opportunity. Nobody wants our service. I said, how am I going to sell someone, develop new business from people who have already said that they don't want your business? He said, that's the challenge. It's easy to sell someone services if they want you, if they recognize that what you have is of value to them. He said, but the real challenge is to sell somebody a business service when they've said they don't need it. And so I went out on my first assignment. I want to share this with you because this is an important part of climbing the mountain of success. Went out on my first assignment. I had a seersucker jacket on. It was in the springtime, and it had a red lining inside of it. I will never forget it as long as I live. I had gotten an appointment with Avon, Vice President of Public Relations. He agreed to see me, to hear my story about these good services that they needed, only he didn't know about it yet. And so I walked into his office and sat there and commenced to tell him about these wonderful services, and fear set in on me. I'd never experienced that kind of fear before. There's all different kinds of fear, but I was so nervous that I began to perspire. And I perspired so freely that the red lining from my jacket soaked through my shirt and through my undershirt. It's true, when I got home that night, I had a red undershirt. The Vice President of Public Relations witnessed this, you know, my perspiring and the nervousness and whatnot. He offered me a glass of Coca-Cola and a glass of water, and he, you know, was very friendly and very nice to me. But it was that experience, as traumatic as it was, that started me on my career. And every year, for 5 years, I would have a meeting with the Vice President of Public Relations. And we would talk, and we became good friends. I never got any business out of him. And one day, the phone rang. I was in the office, wasn't thinking about Avon. And the Vice President of Public Relations was on the other end. And he said that he had a problem, and he needed a management consultant. And the only person that he could think of was me. And if I would come to his office, he would like to share that problem with me. And I did. And from that day on, my firm was able to solve that problem, and we were retained by the Avon Corporation. Okay? Now, you may say, well, that's an interesting story, but, you know, how does that impact on me? It was part of my climb. All right? It was part of my climb. Now, a lot of us will look for the easy way, but there is no easy way. There is no easy way. I want to share with you that I do believe that we have choice in life. Life is full of choices. You always have a choice. You can do this or do that. You can do something or do nothing. The choice is yours. So the idea that you may feel locked, trapped in a career that is not offering you anything, or that you no longer feel passionate about, okay, is really not what you think it is. That situation is not. Okay. I encourage you to come up a little higher in consciousness and see the possibilities of change. No one can define your career or the career path that you should travel. Only you can do that. You have to empower yourself. Okay. That climb to the top encourages you to address some important questions. And these are the questions that I think you will have to deal with. Are you a positive or negative traveler? Well, do you see things from a positive perspective or from a negative perspective? Are you easily defeated, discouraged, or are you determined in spite of? You indicated that the world seems to be turning upside down. It's not like it used to be. But the truth of the matter is, the world is constantly turning upside down. Change is ever present. And yes, it is true that there are people out there in the world who are not quite honest, who are maybe not honest at all. But does that stop you from doing what you have to do, what you need to do? Okay? And so I say, are you a weak traveler or are you a determined traveler? These are important personality issues that will either encourage success or failure. An old Chinese proverb that says, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. And I don't know how many of you are willing to take that step, but you need to do that. I have reinvented myself 7 times, and I'm continuing to do that. I suspect that there are some people in here who need to reinvent themselves and their careers. The first opportunity was as a group worker, which, nice job, but it just wasn't for me. The second opportunity was as the intern, which I spent a year before I became a full-time paid account manager. And then with the Gibson organization, I ended up staying there 9 years. 9 years. A total of 10 if you count my internship. Okay. Good job, good experience, but I felt I needed to move on. And it was at that point that Avon again came back into my life and offered to hire me. They invited me to come and be their first minority management executive. Up to that time, Avon was 86 years old, and they never had a female or minority, ethnic minority above the level of manager. Never had one. Great giant Avon, world's largest cosmetic company, $3 billion company at the time, and they never had a female or a ethnic minority above the level of manager. Interesting. And I joined that company because I wanted the corporate experience. And I reinvented myself from a management consultant to a corporate executive. Now, when you reinvent yourself, you have to be good at doing that. It's not acceptable to be marginal. Okay? You really have to study and be good at it. Excellence is important. I spent 13 years at the Avon Corporation and decided I needed to continue my climb. And at that point in my career, I created my own company, Cameron Enterprises, which is a management consulting business. We provide organizational development, staff training and development, and coaching for profit and nonprofit organizations. I also moved on to another development, which was to become a writer. This is my third publication. I've written 3 books. And you may recall that I told you a person at the Avon Corporation encouraged me to write. And I refused because I didn't think I had anything to say. But for a person that didn't have anything to say, I have now published 3 books, and I'm working on another one. What I discovered was that I had a facility to do how-to kind of books. I've never written a novel. Don't plan to write one. But something inside of me that I discovered enabled me to break down certain material and add to it certain insights, analysis, meaning and understanding such that you could write a book. You could write a book. And so I have become a writer of books. I have also gone on to become a college professor. And I have taught at Mega Evers College for 12 years. It fits hand in glove with the management consulting and the writing. Don't you see it? Surely you can see it. It is possible for you to do many things in your lifetime, not just one, but many. Many of the individuals that I worked with at the Avon Corporation also owned personal businesses, owned apartments, buildings up in Harlem. I had no idea. One executive had an air freight business. So it is possible for you to do many things. It depends upon how you see it. You set the limitations on yourself. But if you see the path, if you're willing and determined to make the climb, it is all possible. In this book, I have established something I call the 7 corporate noble truths for those who would like to be successful in organizational America, whether it's profit or nonprofit. And here are the noble truths. Let me read them off to you. The first noble truth to be successful in an organization in America is the right attitude. It is very difficult for you to be successful in organizational America if you do not have the right attitude. So much so that you understand the thinking of the organization and you can relate to it. That will shape your attitude. Point 2, the right clothes. It's called dress code. You know, after you develop the proper mindset, you have to package it so that you not only think the way they think, but you look like them as well. Now, some of you say, well, I don't know if I want to do that. I want to wear my jeans. Well, okay. But if you want to be successful in organizational America, they will encourage you to not only think the way they think, but also to look as they look in your attire. The third is the right speech. I call it speaking skills. Communications in organizational America is critical to the process. And so you have to learn all the jargon, the idiomatic expressions, you know, because people need to communicate. They need to understand one another. The fourth is on-time habits. Believe it or not, business in the West associate time with money. And so if you're wasting my time, you are wasting my money. If you're stealing the time of the company, of the organization, you're stealing the money. Management skills, time management skills are critical to the process. The right prose, the ability to write and write well is important if you want to be successful in organizational America. One poorly written memorandum to the wrong person or the powerful person in that organization could seriously impact on your career. So your ability to communicate in writing as well as orally is important. The sixth is the right presentation skills. Organizational America, for whatever reasons, and politicians as well, like people who can perform. They're like Hollywood. They like folks who have good presentation skills. Even the President of the United States is criticized because of his presentation skills. And it is true in organizational America as well. And so we need to work on that, perfect our organizational skills such that you can make a good presentation. I teach a course in organizational behavior at Megar Evans, and I make all of my students stand in front of the class and present, just to have the experience of doing that. It's interesting about this thing we experience, we call it fear, standing up in front of a group, and you're a teacher, so you know something about that, okay? In front of your peers is a very powerful thing, and it can cause you some serious fear. The next noble truth is the right politics. Many of us are naive about politics. Some of us go to Organizational America thinking that there is a democracy in that organization. I assure you, no democracy exists in Organizational America. Okay. So don't do that. There is a body politic in all of these organizations, and it becomes important for you to learn what that body politic is all about early on in your career. Okay. Some of you, having learned it, may decide, well, I don't want to be part of that. Okay. But if you want to be successful in that organization, you need to know something about the politics that go on in that organization. The politics, for the most part, is rooted in the organizational culture. And the culture has to do with the values, the traditions, how we see things around here, how we do things around here is connected with the organizational culture. Now, how many of you would like to consider having your own company, you're forming your own organization, becoming an entrepreneur, okay? You can do that. You know, you can work for somebody if you choose, and you can also own your own company, or you can own your own company and not work for someone. You know, you can be the boss. You can set the politics, you know? You can decide who is hired and who is fired. But if you want to lead a career as a business person or establishing some kind of entrepreneurship, it is important for you to consider these issues. First, you need to establish a plan to get started, a business plan. And that business plan should be able to identify what business you want to go in and why you want to do it. If you don't really know why you want to do something, it is very difficult to be motivated to do it. You also need to be able to write a business plan that will encourage you to be successful. Good plans encourage people to be successful when they go into business. You need to identify the resources that are required, both financial and otherwise. You need to know what steps you need to take to get started. If you want to be successful in business or to be a successful entrepreneur, I encourage you to remember this concept. Find a need and fill it. Find a need and fill it. Those of you who want to go into business or become a business owner, I share with you also they will not be easy. 50% of all businesses in the U.S. fail within the first 5 years. Now, should that discourage you? Not if you really want to go into business. There are so many people who are successful in business. Why would you not take the risk? So, I say to you that whether you want to go into business or work for someone, recognize that it is all a competitive environment, that you need to be prepared to be assertive and to compete with those who are interested in the same business that you are interested in. I would like to ask another question. Wealth generation. Wealth? Have you heard of wealth? Okay. How many of you here tonight would like to create wealth in your lifetime? Anybody? Want to do that? Okay. All right. Don't be bashful. You notice there's some who didn't raise their hand, so they maybe they don't want to do that. I don't have a problem with that. It's really up to you. But I want to offer some suggestions. There is a career path for those of us who wish to create wealth, okay, in this country. But I encourage you to recognize that those people who work 9-to-5 jobs, so-called regular 9-to-5 jobs, are generally not the people who create wealth. More often, wealth is created by business owners who happen to make a lot of money, or by investors who make good investments, or by people who inherit money. You know, that's possible. And you can develop wealth from that source. The Donald Trumps of the world, I understand they have some young people who are, he has two young people who are developing some of the Trump properties. And I'm sure when Mr. Donald Trump passes on, his children, no doubt, will inherit a lot of money. But the important thing is that it is part of the climb. And the wealth is available for you to develop if you really want to. Oprah Winfrey has developed some wealth. Right? Mr. Gates has developed some wealth. Who else that you can think of has a lot of wealth in this country?
Walton.
Who? Walton's wealth. Warren Buffett, wealth. They get dressed every day just like you. Brush their teeth, comb their hair. They get headaches. No difference. No difference. The difference essentially is whether or not you really want to do it. And so I say, if you're going to climb that mountain of success, be determined and be creative. Okay? Be passionate about the work that you do. And find a need and fill it. No matter what you plan to do, you will have to be concerned about change. One of the only things in life that is permanent is change. And I want to share with you, in summary, my comments and thoughts about change. Oops. Okay. My suggestions here are to take charge of change. Don't be afraid to change. It keeps life's possibilities open to you. Accept change and manage it. With the exception of God's love and truth, change is one of the things in life that is certain. Change is a deeply personal experience, seen by many as a threat to their security. A lot of people are afraid of change because they don't know what's going to happen to them. They don't like what they're presently doing, but they're afraid to change. The truth is, however, you can change a negative experience by changing the way you see it. And now I want to give you some tips on the process of managing change. And there is a process. After I put this overhead on, I'll come back and allow you to copy these. Don't be concerned. Managing the process of change. I encourage you to break with the past. Let it go. Too many of us live in the past. What happened yesterday and last week and the month before? Break with it. I don't care how many years you have been in teaching. Forget it. Recognize the opportunity to go, to grow. Welcome a new beginning. And remember, nothing ventured, nothing gained. Hide from risk, and you hide from its rewards. Have a vision. See it clearly and rightly. Make a plan with details and options. Set your goals and objectives. Be a realist. Reject feelings of defeat. Be determined. Have faith and maintain that faith. Now I'd like to entertain some questions from you. Any of you who would like to see the previous overhead, I will put that on. As I said, it's the
questioning exchange part of this presentation, I think, may be of real value to you. Put the lights on.
Thank you. Yes.
I've enjoyed your presentation, but my big question is going back to the title, Career Moves for the Minority Manager.
Yes.
Your presentation could have been applied to general population and been effective. But how different is it for the minority manager?
Well, it's a good question. Actually, this book has been written so that anyone can benefit from it. There are some experiences that women and minorities can benefit from in reading this book because of the special issues that come up in organizational America, where women and ethnic minorities are faced with it. They don't always know, for example, whether they have not received a promotion because they are female or an ethnic minority, or if the skill level, competition-wise, was the reason for that. And so I tried to focus on issues like that, such that people can understand a greater appreciation for the issues that, no matter how subtle they are, that ethnic minorities and women are faced with in organizational America. As I pointed out to you, when I joined Avon in 1972, it was the world's largest cosmetic company. But interesting enough, there were no women or minorities in the upper management of Avon. Now, is that to suggest that there were no competent females who could make decisions about cosmetics and beauty aids? I think not. But, you know, that's the way things are. Did that answer your question?
One of them is that we're not sure if there's discrimination and whether it's other issues. I think that's definitely one thing that you've hit on. But I think there's some other issues out there that are relevant to the minority manager that puts us in the dark more often than not.
Well, part of it, and you, that's a good follow-up to it, part of it has to do with the politics of the organization and what they call the old boy network. Okay, if you're not part of that old boy network, you know, there is little likelihood that you will have the information or be able to compete with individuals who have better information to compete with. Also, what you find is, in some cases, people tend to identify socially with certain individuals in the organization. And if you don't socialize with individuals in the organization, there is every possibility that that friendship, that camaraderie that is developed and that also influences who gets promoted and who doesn't get promoted, who is valuable, who's not valuable. It's a subtle thing. But nonetheless, it's real, and you see it, you know, organization after organization, institution after institution. It happens all the time. Yes?
In this summer, basically we're told that you're going to tell us something about some written and unwritten rules of life,
yes,
in corporate America. And based on your success in corporate America as a minority executive, So, but what's the end, you know, like, can you get some sample of what's the unwritten rules? That, right. Because that's especially important for people.
Right. Well, excellent question. First of all, let me identify the written rules. The written rules in Organization America are the rules that tend to be published, yes, on paper in the personnel manual, you know, in the annual report, you will see things that relate to the organization's rules and regulations. But beyond that are the unwritten rules. These are the things that are not discussed anywhere. And that chances are you will not know that these rules unless you break one of them. It's rooted in the culture of the organization. And the culture has to do, as I said before, with values, the organization's values, its shared values, its traditions, its, you know, how we do things around here. And unfortunately for many minorities who do not have mentors who can guide them and say, oh, don't go that way, go this way. I'll give you an example. I did something in Avon that was a growth experience for me. I sat in a meeting of executive people. Some of them were senior executives, higher than I was at the time. And there was a discussion about an issue. And I felt so passionate about it, so moved, that I stood up and I said, let me tell you, we should do it this way and not that way. 3 days later, I got a phone call, and one of the senior vice presidents invited me out to lunch. And he said to me, you know, Randy, you had a very good point at the meeting. He says, everyone was interested in that, but why did you stand up? I said, excuse me? He said, why did you stand up? In this organization, one was not encouraged to stand up in a presentation or a response in a meeting, particularly when there were senior people in the room. Not encouraged to do that. And that was a no-no. In effect, I got a little spanking. Okay. I got a little spanking. So, yes?
I thought that was a normal thing to do. You make a presentation of anything in a meeting, and you stand up, you recognize that you are the person who is making the recommendation or any kind of presentation.
But in that organization, it was an unwritten rule that if there were senior people in the room, okay, you did not stand up if they did not stand. And no one had stood up in the room up to that point, but I did.
Strange.
Yes, it's strange. It's an unwritten rule. It's an unwritten rule. And so it becomes important for you to study the culture of an organization if you want to be successful. More people in Organizational America are unsuccessful, not because of the lack of technical skills or know-how, but because of their inability to negotiate the organizational culture, the values, how things are done around here, how they're not done around here, who does them, and so forth and so on. And so if you don't have a mentor, if you will, someone to guide you and tell you, you know, we're going into this meeting, but don't speak, don't say anything, just listen. Or you haven't been here long enough to say anything. You don't have the experience. They will not listen to you. They will not hear you. No matter how profound your comments may be, no matter how right you are. But you have to know that about the organization. And it exists not in simply in a corporation or a nonprofit organization, but in the government. It exists. In the military, it exists. In the military, it's a hierarchical structure that says, do as you are told. don't question the senior people. And so in a hierarchical environment, you find that it's tribal in nature. And it promotes both security and insecurity at the same time. The people at the top feel very secure. The people at the bottom, quaking in their boots, hoping they won't say anything that will not be accepted, that they won't stand up in a meeting when they should sit down, that they won't speak out when it's uninvited.
But what year these kind of you have to study the culture of that organization in order for you to succeed there. But what happens if you believe that culture itself, that organizational structure itself, has its problems or its shortcomings? What do you do?
Well, somebody answer that question. I'll answer it, but somebody answer it for me. Yes. What do you do when the culture, something wrong with the culture?
Well, if there's something wrong with the culture, I would honestly look for an organization that fits my culture, the way I think. Because the goal is to kind of fit into what the goals of the objectives of the company is. Yeah. So,
the reason, let me add it on a little bit more comment on this, because the reason I raised these years from some, based following on my previous comments, is that a lot of organizations in this country actually is falling down or being leaving behind the global trend. And under those kind of circumstances, people inside this organization needs to make change. Or, the one way is that, I don't like this organization. I don't like the culture. I just leave. But on the other hand, maybe you can make a change. You can make a difference. So this is something I think, you can do.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, yeah, I would not tell you that you do not have the right to wage a campaign in an organization to change the culture. I would not tell you that you don't have the right to do that. You do fully have the right to do that. As to how long you will be able to do that, I question, okay? There are some people who create their own agendas, and let's say women's rights or whatever issue that you may want to think of, and lead a campaign to try to change the organization. And in some cases, you can be successful in doing that. But I will say to you, for the most part, if you are concerned about your career in that organization, and that organization has a culture that does not agree with you, you're probably better off to leave the organization and go someplace where the culture is suitable for you, where what you have to contribute is welcomed and needed, okay? Or if you want to, you can set up your own business and you set your own culture. Yes?
Question. I know it should be much more beneficial if you know of the culture of a certain company or organization before you ever enter. So I'm thinking about what's your suggestion on getting those information? I know normally before interviews, we will go from informational interviews. So how can we approach the person who has been working in this organization for years about this type of questions without being too offensive? You know what I mean? Like, just how can we get those cultural-wise information from a person before we ever test the water, because it's kind of dangerous?
Well, I believe that there are some opportunities to do this, but you actually raise a good question in that it is difficult if you're an outsider to get a reading on what's going on inside the organization. But trade associations can provide you with information. Also, the Wall Street community analysts, they can provide you with information. You can request an opportunity to talk to people who work in the organization. Okay, that is possible. Now, any organization that will not allow you to talk to employees, I would want to stay away from, okay? So, you know, take your time and do your homework. Research it well. Find out whether or not this is an organization that you really want to work for. You can look at the good work of the organization to tell whether or not it's a good place to work. It's corporate social responsibility. The organizations that the president belongs to, if the president or CEO of that organization belongs to some questionable organizations, or if you look at the complexion of the management and you see that it's skewed, there are very few, very little evidence of diversity in that organization, you may want to take a second thought about joining the organization. And there's nothing wrong about asking in the interview what the company's philosophy is about. And I would encourage, a lot of us make the mistake of grabbing the job. Okay, we just, oh, we need the job, and we just take the job. And then we get inside the company and find out, oh, I didn't know this. This is not the place I want to be. Okay. But you have to take responsibility in doing the research, the proper research, before you accept the offer. It's not just about money. As I said, ideally, you need to feel passionate about the work that you do. When you get up early in the morning, that you're eager to go there, so that you don't just send the body and leave the mind and the spirit at home. You know, yes?
So how does that help you move up in terms of, you know, a lot of the higher management ups in organizations, you know, aren't reflective of diversity. So if you want to move up, you know, if I say, oh, this isn't reflective of diversity, I'm not going to, you know, work at this organization, even though I do relate to its mission, I do relate to its goals, but it doesn't look like I'm going to fit in, you know, I'm going to go somewhere else. How does that, you know, what do you say, like, what do you suggest in terms of moving up, you know, there is that ceiling for minorities, for women. How far you can get because of the lack of diversity, the lack of that inclusiveness.
Yes, there is such a thing. We hear the term used, glass ceiling, in organizational America. But one of the best ways to break through that glass ceiling is to have good mentors and to have good networks, okay, that you can utilize to break through that. A mentor, both in the company, mentors can be in the company and outside of the company. All right? As long as they understand the politic of the organization and how people get promoted, they can advise you. Right? If the mentor is someone that you trust and that person has knowledge and is willing to support you and give you good guidance, that's basically what you need. And if you get someone who will even speak up for you, that's even better. But the networking and the mentors are really on you. You have to find people who can help you in your career. Now, if you find that the company does not have an interest in making an opportunity for diversity, you know, then you need to think about moving on. Well, I mean, but you can, you know, as you look around the organization, you have opportunities to talk with people and ask, you know, you can ask your supervisor, for example, what career opportunities exist here for me? What do you see? What is required in order for me to move up in the organization? What expectations do you have?
That's that's, you know, the key problem with people like me, you know, or I think a lot of people in this room as well, that so the first thing is the glass ceiling. And the second thing is you can see from the very beginning the limit you normally, you know, go ahead. You know, you just can see it. So, but that's why, actually, you know, in recent years, so many Chinese professionals, they choose returning to China rather than staying here. They got the education here, they got the experience,
And then they decided to go home, go back. And they were doing fine there. And the people stay here, they just like, you know, most of the people, I would say, professional like me, is work to live rather than, you know, reach your, realize your dreams or aspirations. Yeah. 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 That I think this is a big problem for this country.
Yeah. Well, let me say.
Yeah. I know.
Yeah. No, there's nothing wrong with. I mean, global.
But it's a globalization issue. Yeah. But for America,
right.
It's a loss because we are not giving these kind of people very professional, very highly educated, very good, talented, but they are not seeing the opportunities.
Well, I would say this to you: you have every right to challenge the organization in terms of its career opportunities, no question about it. The year that I was appointed director at Avon, they also appointed two female vice presidents, and they put two females on the board. That was unheard of. It was unheard of at Avon. All of the decisions of that giant beauty company was made by white males. But that year, they made a commitment to open up opportunities for ethnic minorities and females. And putting two females on the board was a major step for them. And female vice presidents. Now they've had their CEO has been, who's Oriental, that's right, who's Oriental, Asian person, and at the Avon Corporation. And so that corporations change, they shift based on their desire to reinvent themselves. Because if they don't reinvent themselves, they will go out of business. Right. That's an important consideration. The year that I was made director at Avon, I discovered that I was the first African American, but that the company derived 15% of its business from African Americans in the United States. And we were only 11% of the population. So that meant that African Americans were buying Avon in disproportionate numbers, soaps and makeups and whatever and whatever and whatever. So it made good business sense for this company to integrate its management and allow an inclusiveness to take place so that they had a better understanding of the challenges of the marketplace. And if they decide to go global, clearly, they need to have that integration. Yes?
But still, I mean, you know, for a lot of American companies, even they decide to go global, they still, you know, like the old boys network, they still put the people, their people in the senior management rather than, you know, have the right people running the right, you know, running the business in the right place. And then that's why a lot of companies are losing or faltering in their globalization effort.
Yeah. And I would just say this one thing about that. Yeah. You know, there's nothing wrong with a company going out of business. Nothing wrong with it.
But okay?
If the company is not willing to do the things that are necessary to maintain growth and development, to reinvent itself over and over and over, even if it means bringing in people that they have not, in the past, not had